you have for people out in the world. Amen. Okay. Today I want to talk about the prison of his praises. We all find ourselves in prisons at some time in life. And we also want you to know this in Acts chapter 16. We're going to see two individuals, Silas and Paul, as they find themselves in prison. But in Acts chapter 16 and verse 1, it talks about them going through different countries. And as they were going through, mighty works were being done, preached. People were being saved. And in verse 6, it says, "So the churches were strengthened and made firm in the faith, and they increased in number day after day. And Paul and Silas passed through the territory and the region of Galatia." Now I want you to see something here. "And were forbidden by the Holy Ghost. They're hearing the voice of the Good Shepherd." So they were on their way to Galatia. Holy Spirit said, "No, that's not where I want you to go." Verse 7. "And they were to going to the Mysia, and they said to go into Bithynia, but the Holy Spirit told them no." So you know what the interesting thing is? That we ought to be going and God will be directing. But a lot of times we don't go because we don't know where to go. But Jesus doesn't care where you go when you put your feet to your faith. Listen, Jesus, you'll direct your way, but the Lord will guide your path. You move, at least you're moving, and then all of a sudden, when you're moving, and you're hearing the voice of the Good Shepherd, he'll show you where you need to go. And here in verse 9, "And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed, saying, 'Come over into Macedonia and help us.'" So finally, he's getting some direction. "And therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothrace, and the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia, and a certain colony, and were in that city abiding certain days." And we see here something, verse 13, "And on the Sabbath we went out of the city by riverside, where prayer was wont to be made." Where prayer was wont to be made, and it goes on and it says, "And we sat down and spoke unto the woman." What are they doing? Preaching the gospel. Saints, what these young youth are doing. Saints, what we're supposed to be doing. 14. "And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, in the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, and she attended unto the things which were spoken by God." So here, by Paul. So here they are. Paul went from Mysia, was forbidden from Bithynia to Mysia, but all of a sudden ended up in Philippi because God led him there. Lydia, all of a sudden, hears the word, she attended to the things of God, and all of a sudden Paul comes across a woman with a spirit of divination, and how God directs their steps. And now it goes on and says, they were doing this because of money. So then Paul cast out the demon of divination, and when he did that, the spirit came out. And you can see all along, God's directing their steps, and good things are happening. Well, how many know when you go places, good things happen? And I'm going to tell you this, in verse 19, because of that, when the master heard, master saw that their hope of profit was gone, see, we realize this, they're coming to a place, and I want to tell you something about this. You and I are going to come to places, and this first place they came to was a place of misery. Master saw their hope of profit, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities, and they brought them to the magistrates and said, "These men, being Jews, exceeding trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe." Then the multitude rose up together against them, See, these gentlemen went in and they faced, Paul and Silas faced the misery of accusation. They went in and they were saying, they're not teaching our customs. Or they are, and they're not supposed to do that. The multitudes rose up against them. Saints, multitudes are going to rise up against you. And multitudes are going to rise up against you for doing the right thing. Everybody thinks as a Christian that things are going to be going good and good and good, and you're never going to face anything bad. But I'm here to tell you, Paul and Silas were doing what was good. And sometimes you and I as Christians will go out into the world, we'll do what we need to do, and we'll find out, even though we're doing what's right, we're still being rose up against. But if we don't quit, and we press through those things that are coming up against us, and if we end up in a place of misery where they ended up, we're going to see this, they ended up in a place, a prison place. And it says, and the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Stripped of your possessions, keep them securely. Now listen, they stripped them. They had stripes and beaten with rods. And how many times in our life are we? We have stripes. We're stripped of possessions. We're stripped of things we love. We're stripped of our confidence. Whatever it is that we're trying to hold on to in life, we're going to be thrown into the prison because the very things we hold on to, you know what? The devil's going to come and try to strip you of those things. You may not have confidence because you were stripped of your confidence. But I'm telling you here, even though you're in the land of misery, you're going to come out. So they wanted them to stay. The Bible says the jailer to keep them secure. See, if Paul and Silas could be kept in jail, then the Holy Spirit would have never came out. And that's what the enemy's out to do. He's out to beat you with stripes, strip you of your self-confidence, so that you'll never come out of who you are and do the works of God. Because he doesn't want the Holy Spirit to have his power to do what he needs to do if he can be you and I confined without coming out of that prison through praise. The next thing was the misery of accommodations. Having received such a charge, he put them in the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. These things, you know, see, we realize that they went into the inner prison. They actually came to a place where they were fastened in stocks. It's not like today. I've been in prisons today, and I see the guys lifting weights and doing. It's almost like a hotel, motel. But these were guys who were in the inner stocks. If you ever saw the movie Pac-Man, Solitary Confinement, you're in the room all by yourself. It's very dark. You're eating cockroaches because there's no food except the little bit they gave you. And I'm here to tell you this. It's so, if you saw the movie, this is a picture of what I can see Paul and Silas saying. They're in a place, in an inner prison. But I'm here to tell you this, saints. You and I, we go through trials in life. In this world, you shall face trials. In this world, I've spoken this to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. In the world you will end up in prisons. In the world, he says, be of good cheer, for he has overcome the world. There are times in our life when we will do our best to serve the Lord, but he will still put us in a prison situation. He will put us there because he wants to take the prison out of us. He's there. It'll be a place of misery, suffering. Diseases may come. Children may rebel. Marriages may fail. Sometimes life hurts, and all the prayers in this world will not prevent you and I from going into a prison experience. Did you hear what I said? All the prayers in this world are going to stop us from going where we don't want to go. Paul put it this way. Before I was afflicted, I went astray. The afflictions aren't coming to try and get you. The afflictions are coming to steal the word that's in your heart. So they threw him in this prison, but here's the key. Well, the prayers won't get you out of the prison situation. God puts us in the prison situation, and that's the place of ministry. So he goes from a place of misery to the ministry of a nation, but now it comes to a place you make this place of misery. And many people, when they go through these hard times, they're put in the experience of life. They want to be out of the prison. Get me out of here, Lord, I'll serve you. Get me out of here, Lord, and I'll do what you want me to do. But Jesus puts you in there for a purpose. And I'm going to say this to you. It's a place of ministry. Why do I say that? It says, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing. They were in the prison because God wanted to use the prison so that he can use the prison to come to a place where he can see the power. And that's what it is here. He's saying, praying. I say this, you're going to be put in the prison, but the Lord wants to see you, how you react in the prison that you're put in. Because the world is seeing you and I put in prisons, but they're not seeing Christianity. Because the Christians that are put in the prison, the praises aren't coming out of their mouth to show them there's a Christ that's going to deliver them. True Christianity, saints, isn't a sweet bed of roses. True Christianity, hey, look, what are you and I made of in the hard times? It's easy to sing praise and worship to God. It's easy to go through life and you're a Christian and you're thanking God and you're a Christian and you're praising the Lord. But the Lord wants to know what you're made of, and the world wants to know what you're made of, because when you're in the prison and they see you praise, they say, hey, I want the Christ Jesus that they know. What is the hope that lies within you? Let's give them something to hope about. So they're in this ministry at midnight. Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the prisoners were listening to this. Listen, and the prisoners, one translation says, were listening intently to Paul and Silas as they prayed. They're listening intently. You know, we say we go out and we have to preach the gospel, we got to tell people about Jesus. By God's gift, that's what the great mission is. But you know, when you don't get the opportunity because you're in a prison, you can be in the prison by your actions, showing the praise and worship, and the prisoners are listening intently to see whether you got his life or not. Can you hear what I'm saying? They're listening intently to the prayer. So now it becomes a place of powerful ministry. They were not only praising God and seeking God for themselves, but the powerful ministry as the prisoners were intently listening to Paul and Silas as they praised. Suddenly, how many say, when is suddenly? Suddenly, foundations of prison shaken immediately. This is a verse packed with action. All of a sudden, God moves the power in one moment of all. The prisoners that were chained were unchained. How many are you and I? How many of you, how many out there actually are chained to some things in your life? Some addiction, something that's trying to come against you. And this is the key. These prisoners were chained down, but they were all free. The chains and the shackles came off. Why? Because of the praising. Praising in the hymns. But listen to this. It happened at the midnight hour. You know, we say, oh, man, I know what I'm going through. But there's a midnight hour, saints. What's a midnight hour? It's the place between light and darkness. And just when it looks like everything's gone bad and nothing good is going to happen, there's that midnight hour. And you know where that midnight hour is? Right here, saints. Right here. It's in the prison sometimes of our minds. As they prayed, their prison was transformed from a place of pain into a place of praise. Paul and Silas began to sing songs of praise unto the Lord. When we praise God, I'm going to tell you what, saints, our foundations are going to be shaken. Their foundations here were shaken immediately. When? Suddenly, their foundations were shaken. God wants to rattle our foundations, saints. He wants not only rather the things that hurt us, he wants to rather the things that, that hurt us that are connected to the hurts. He wants to come in and rattle your cage. And how do you do that? You come boldly to the throne room of grace to find mercy and grace in time of need. How do you do that? Jesus said, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and I will show you great and mighty things. How does he do that? This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know he hears us, we know we have the petitions we ask of him. When you find yourself locked away in a prison experience, God is there. What's your response going to be? Spurgeon said this, any fool can sing in the day. It is easy to sing when we can read the notes by daylight. But the skillful singer is he who can sing when there is not a ray of light to read by. Songs in the night come only from God. They are not in the power of man. In chapter 27 of Acts 16, and it says, and the keeper of the prison saw the doors open, awakening. And the keeper was awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open. He drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. You see, back in those days, you were watching over the prisoners and the prisoners escaped, and your life was on hand from the magistrates, so they were going to kill you because you let the prisoners out. So this individual here, the guard, said, hey, look, I'm going to kill myself before I can kill my whether it's myself killing me or the magistrates killing me. So as he was ready, it says here, so he went, drew the sword, would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. I want to ask you a question. As you're praising and worshiping God in your life, if you're in a prison in your life, if the shackles are broken in your life like Paul and Silas, what would be if you're in their condition do when the chains are broken and you're in that prison? Exit stays up. I'm a prisoner. The chains are broken. The magistrates are gone. The city officials are gone. I'm out of here now because Jesus got me out of here because of my praise and worship. But you know what? Did you notice they never left? Did you notice their job wasn't done yet? Did you notice God put them in the prison so he could get the gospel to these people that were in the prison? Did you notice that not only did they preach the gospel and they listened and they saw God move in these prisoners' life? Did you notice that the officials and the magistrates, it was a testimony to them? Did you notice that Lydia brought back Paul and Silas to their household and their family got saved? You see, just because we're in the prisons of life doesn't mean God can put us in there and get the gospel to somebody else. Do you hear what I'm saying? And so what we see here, it says, Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do yourself no harm. Do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. And brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved in your house. And they spoke unto him the word of the Lord, and all that were in his house heard it and got saved. You see, saints, the prison is a place of power if you will let it be. The prison isn't a place of escape, because when you're in him, no prison can hold you. The prison is in our mind, and he's putting us in the prison so that he can unchain us from things that have us chained, and then we can do the work of the ministry and get other people saved. It's a about, the gospel is about salvation things. He that winneth souls is wise. And it goes on here. And he said, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Verse 33, and he took them in the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and were baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he had brought them into the house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with his whole house. And when it was day, the magistrate sent the sergeant, saying, let those men go. And the keeper of the prison told, saying to Paul, the magistrates have sent for let you go. Now therefore, listen to Paul and Silas. Now therefore, depart and go back to them. They're sending you, but I want you to tell the magistrates and not the city officials something here. Paul said to them, they have beaten us openly uncondemned, being Romans. They've cast us into the prison, and now do they trust us out privately? Nay, not merely. Let them come themselves and fetch us out. They wanted the other people to do the dirty work, but Paul and Silas wanted to look at the city officials straight on and say, hey, look. And the sergeants told his words up to the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them and brought them out, and desired them to depart out of the city. And they went out of the prison and entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed. See, by him sending the people back and going back to the sergeants and the magistrates, the sergeants and the magistrates said, let them go. So here's the testimony. They put him into the prison for the purpose of taking the gospel of Jesus Christ to others and getting people saved and testifying on the way of their prison experience. And I want to say to you today, what is it? What's keeping you and I? Is it possible that he sent us to prison just like he Paul and Silas to save a jailer and his family? Look at the outcome. Also, sometimes you'll never get out of the why God puts us in places, or we even put ourselves in places. Listen, Jonah went into the whale. Also, Job. Okay, but look at the results. 9 months, Job was, forgot how much more. And what about us? Malcolm Butteridge, a Christian writer, said, contrary to what might be expected, I look back on 75 years of experience that at the time seemed especially desolating and painful, with a particular satisfaction. Indeed, I can say with complete truthfulness that everything I have learned in my 75 years in this world, everything that has truly enhanced and enlightened my experience, has been through afflictions and not through happiness. You can't move. Paul and Silas couldn't move. But guess what? Paul and Silas were locked in the stocks. They could move, but they could still praise. Some of you are locked in stocks. Some of you are chained to certain things. But you can still move your mouth. You can still praise the Lord. You can't have the fire of purpose without some heat of persecution. Are you going to let your chains break your praise, or are you going to let your praise break your chains? Have you ever felt chained to something? Attitudes, addictions, depression, oppression, anger, and so on. This doesn't mean you can't lift up your voice, clap your hands, and praise God. Saints, your enemy wants to keep you focused on where you are bound. He doesn't want you to look at what's good. He doesn't want you to look at what God is putting you in so God can use you in so that he can bring others through and so that his glory can be manifested through you. But my saints, my fellow saints, say this with me. My praise breaks pain. When the prison door slams behind you, and you find yourself locked down tight in the chains of your pain and problems, you and I need to lift our voice and praise to Him. And every chain will be broken. That better will be broken. And as you raise your voice to Him in praise, no matter what chain you're going through,
yeah. Praise the Lord. We're going to continue to worship with a few more songs. If you feel led. The Apostle Paul declared, I am a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray for your people here today that they go forth, not feel like they're locked in a prison, but use the prison for an opportunity to be a prisoner of the Lord. So even though Paul was bound in chains, he still did what you called him to do. And Father, as we go forth today, let every prison experience we are put in be praises from our lips in the midnight hour.
Oh, yes.
In the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, come forth. So, Lord, whatever affliction it needs to take, we will use it to bring forth glory to you. And it will not have victory over us. Well, Lord, we're not the victim, we're the victor. So therefore, Lord, as we go forth today, we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who loved us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.